Hello, guys. My name is Chris. I have the privilege to serve along you here at Vista Church for some time now. And it's really an honor when I walk this morning here and Brandon told me you get to preach today. So let's see how this one goes. Let's brace for impact. I get the privilege usually on Sundays to be with the kids ministry. And you know how to raise kids. Many of you here are their parents, their moms. So that's how we're going to be conducting the message today. With an iron fist and a ring of terror. So, a la James Bond, I have in my power the remote control for the snow machines. If I see you snoozing, it will start snowing. So now you know, okay? I keep it here. I keep it handy. So let's give it a shot. It's amazing, right, how the day after Christmas becomes. It's like our muscles, right, get relaxed and our wallets get tense. Jeff was telling me that one of the Christmas gifts was actually going to a football game. If that's a gift, I guess, for some people. And he got to walk a mile, right, from when he was until the stadium to watch the game. And the day after, now when you start feeling it, right? The same is with the holidays sometimes. All the tension, all the effort, all the decorations, all the last-minute running. Thank you for the Walgreens tip at midnight. Really useful, Dennis. Getting presents and the whole thing, right? And now we get to relax. And in this morning, I want to invite you to think about something that is very important. Not for us as Christians or church goers, not even if it's your first time here at church, it's something that affects us to the very core of the human race. And that is going to be the title of our message. And the title of our message for today is, when is okay to regift something we don't like? And we are going to go over three reasons why we shouldn't be regifting something that it has been given to us. Why we shouldn't miss on that opportunity, on holding on to it. Might be too late for some. I see that somebody already gave some of the white elephant gifts from the youth to their brothers. That's low, Nico. Now, but interesting enough, I love statistics, and we are going to do a quick game. And this is going to be the top five gifts that get regifted, so you know, okay? So let's go in the chart, and in number five, we have jewelry. And think about it. Yes, I'm shocked. You won't believe number one, Dennis. So number five is jewelry. So if you guys went cheap, that will go away. So, number four, picture frame. I saw that coming, okay? We have too many picture frames. And if you need one, we have an office full of them that we use for different events, and I don't know what to do with them. So, that would be probably one of the prizes for the cornhole. Picture frame. Number three, gift basket. Careful with this one. If you got a gift card or a gift basket or too many, and there's some of the stuff that you don't like, I say, oh, I can regift that one. Do it right away. You don't want to be the one regifting some olives due in 2000, okay? So gift basket, proceed with caution on that one. Number two, you won't believe number one. Housewares, toasters, coffee makers, you know, blenders, all those things, number two on the list. Okay, number one. Before we go to number one, clothing. Oh, we did already. Clothing. I thought it was going to be something completely different, but clothing is the number one gift that is passing along. Now, Christmas is over. We're still finding that little Lego piece that rolled under the sofa. Eventually, we'll show up with a thousand other things, right? Our recycled bins probably are full with car boxes and gift wrap paper, and we are done, right? It's already outside. We are cleaning out. I had a friend that actually the day, Christmas morning, after opening the presents, the first thing they did, take down the Christmas tree. I know, savage, I know. But that's how it is for some people, okay? That's it. Let's turn over the page. Actually, in one of our midnight runs getting presents, I saw at Walgreens, they already are stocking with Valentine's hearts and chocolates. This morning, if you stop by, you will probably see them first row and all the Christmas stuff on clearance. That's when I do my shopping. Now, and also there is the real story of Christmas. And this is when we go to the point this morning. When Jesus was born, the baby, and anyone here in this room that had the blessing and the opportunity to become a mom, to be a father, right? I want you to remember that moment where you were not in a manger, hopefully, but in a hospital, or somebody was helping you, and in your first kid, right, you delivered the baby. And I remember when Lucas was born, immediately there is a whole team of nurses going around and stamping his feet, his hands, measuring temperature, washing them, getting it all ready, clothed, you know, warm. They put him in like a little light so he keeps warm, and then he put them with Karina so he will be, you know, connecting with her and everyone, and taking so much care of this baby, right? And I'm just watching every single step. And then the next day comes, and the nurse hands you the baby and tells you, well, Dad, it's on you now. And I went, no, can you come with me, please? Right? The terrifying moment when you have to leave the hospital, right? Making sure that the car seat works, you know, test driving it, make the house is fireproof for 1,000 things, even if the little thing cannot even move. We already have locked the toilet and the whole thing. I don't know what we were expecting, right? But that's the natural fear that you can have as a dad. Imagine the day after Jesus was born. Shepherds went back to tend their flock. You know, life continues as usual for so many. The doors open and they have right there in the same manger, wrapping, collecting their things to move along with a baby now. The pressure, right? We sing that Mary, did you know? Yes, she knew. She had an angel, she told him. But so many things that come with parenthood. How to take care of this gift from God. The adventure begins. And the same for many of us. It's not that we are wrapping up a cycle. And yes, it's great all the things that we were able to witness and be part of, on even this year here at church. But looking forward, what is God preparing us for? So I want you to please join me in Luke chapter 2. And we are going to be picking up pretty much a week after Jesus was born. And this is something that it was custom. This is something that it gets done. 8 days later, in verse 21, it's not going to show up in the screen, but you can follow in your Bibles. Chapter 2, verse 21. 8 days later, when the baby was circumcised, he was named Jesus, the name given by him by the angel, even before he was conceived. Then it was time for the purification offering as required by the law of Moses after the birth of a child. So his parents took him to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. The law of the Lord says, if a woman's first child is a boy, he must be dedicated to the Lord. So they offered the sacrifice required in the law of the Lord, either a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. So, following all the law for Jesus. He's a boy, a sacrifice needs to be done, the circumcision needs to be proceeded. So 8 days later, this is happening. And this has to happen in Jerusalem. So again, Mary, Joseph, and now Jesus start walking, making their way into Jerusalem. Now, let's continue in verse 25. At that time, there was a man in Jerusalem named Simeon. He was righteous and devout and was eagerly waiting for the Messiah to come and rescue Israel. The Holy Spirit was upon him, and he had revealed to him that he would not die until he had seen the Lord's Messiah. That day, the Spirit led him into the temple. So when Mary and Joseph came to present the baby Jesus to the Lord, as the Lord required, Simeon was there. He took the child in his arm and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, now let your servant die in peace, as you have promised. I have seen your salvation, which you have prepared for all people. He is the light. He is a light to reveal God to the nations. And he is the glory of your people, Israel." It's the joy of the unexpected, even when you are expecting it. That is a gift. Right, many here, especially my friends, the kiddos. Right, you probably made a list, right, of your things that you wish to get. And usually, the way it works, you make like we did a few minutes ago. You do your top three or top five or top 20, right, of gifts that you are expecting to get. Right, and always at the top of the list is the thing that you desire the most. Well, Simeon, this man of God, he was righteous. He was a man that it was in the heart of God. He wanted to follow God. And he got this promise from him that he will not die until he will see the Savior, the Messiah. And that day, when a young couple is walking into the temple with a baby, he sees them, and he goes and he grabs Jesus, and he prays God for this baby because he recognizes that he was the Messiah. The gift of the unexpected, even where we are expecting it. Sometimes the emotion is so, so big. We start screaming and jumping from joy. Or sometimes we just get perplexed and we don't know how to react, right? And in this case, this man, he saw this gift from God. He was waiting for the Messiah. That means he was waiting for someone that will save Israel, for someone that they will give freedom to this nation that has been oppressed for so many years. If I would be in that temple, I wouldn't be looking for a baby. Don't you? I would be looking for a warrior. I would be looking for a man walking, like maybe with a few others behind him, getting into the temple, ready to give a speech, ready to start the revolt right then, right there, because that's what God promised me. That I will see the Savior. I will see the Messiah. I will see the guy that will give freedom to my people. But Simeon understood that it wasn't about a revolt, that it wasn't about politics. It wasn't about the oppression from a nation over another one. It was about the salvation of their soul. Actually, in the ESV version, in other versions, they would talk, this is not just for Israel. This is for the whole world. Gentiles apply. So Simeon understood that this gift that he was expected, even if it came in an unexpected package, as a baby, as a child, it was a gift worth holding. It was a gift worth sharing. So many times we get frustrated, right? When you get your gift, that happened yesterday to my daughter. She received one of these dolls, and I don't know what's happening in this world. And why a doll requires 55 different straps and screws to hold it into the cardboard. So she opens the present, right? This princess warrior, and she's ready to fight, but the princess couldn't fight because she was tied, so tight that daddy was trying to unscrew, and she was like, okay, I move to the next present and I will come back for this one later. And sometimes we are like that. We believe, we trust in Jesus, but we lose our patience and we move. And it says, okay, God, while you try to fix this for me, I'm going to go and I'm going to find my own solutions. I'm going to find my own right now satisfaction. And when you show up, I'll come back to you. Guys, that's not the way it works. God wants us to be faithful to him, even in the unexpected times. God wants us to be patient and loving and careless and nurture this love. That's what this man did. He waited patiently. So, even if you're expecting it and when you get it, it's not really what you were expecting it, hold into it. It has a promise. It has a future. This man, he had this conviction. He has this strong belief that the Messiah was going to walk to the temple doors that morning. It says, that day the Spirit led him to the temple. He was there. Simeon was there. So important for us to be present, to be there in the presence of our God. Let's keep reading. You can imagine all the things that they are happening to these new parents. And Mary's holding the baby. A week ago, Jesus was delivered into a manger, right? Not place for a baby to be born. And now she walks into the temple, and this old man approaches her and grabs the baby and pretty much tells her exactly the same things that she heard from the angel. And he goes on and he says, verse 33, Jesus' parents were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, the baby's mother, spoilers, this child is destined to cause many in Israel to fall and many others to rise. He has been sent as a sign from God, but many will oppose him. As a result, the deepest thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your very soul. One reason that we shouldn't pass along a gift is because we need to consider the emotional value that that gift has. That's what I call the expensive stuff. You know, it's not how much it costs, it's how much love was poured into it. Now, again, for those who are parents, you know the joy of having a baby. You know the cares and how you will protect them. And even if they are 25, they will still be your babies, right? And even if they are 40, they're still your babies, right? That's how my mom treats me, like a big baby. Actually, that's how my wife treats me. But that, we'll talk about that another time. Now, this verse makes reference to Mary. Simeon was telling Mary, okay, this baby, he will become a great man, and many will follow him, and many will love him, and he will do an impact for humanity. But be prepared, he will be rejected. Imagine you as a mother, and they tell you, your kid will be rejected. That's not something we like. And your kid will suffer. And that pain, Mary, will hurt your very soul. It will be like you are getting trespassed with a sword. That's how much it's going to hurt you. The emotional value on this gift that you have, on this child, on this baby, 8 days old, and they are telling you he's going to suffer, he's going to be rejected. That's going to hurt. That is something that is going to be take a toll on your own heart. And let me talk a little bit about this baby. That 33 years later, he will be dying on a cross. not for anything he did. He will be insulted. He will be tortured. He will be made fun of. And then he will have the worst execution that a human being could have at that day. The crucifixion was the worst type of punishment for any human being. But they went above and beyond, and they nailed his hands and his feet, and he was thirsty, and they put a crown of thorns. Thank you. Thank you for the translation. He wanted to do it bilingual. Now, this baby was going to suffer. And all that beating up, all that mocking, all that torture, all that blood, all that pain was nothing compared with the emotional status of Jesus Christ on the cross, the moment that he was carrying my sins and your sins. And I know it's a very churchy word. Sins means when we do something that is not in God's target. When we fail the target, we don't do something right, that's called a sin. Even if it's something that we, like we learn on Sunday mornings, right, kids? If it's something that we do, or something we say, or even something we think, and there is away from what God desired, that's what the Bible calls sin. So we don't have to list and make a huge list of all the things that are wrong. We just call it sin. And there is nothing that we can give God. There is not something that we can buy. There is not something unexpected that we can surprise God. It's not something that we can put our emotional work into it and give God that will buy back our forgiveness, our sin. So that's why Jesus had to pay this price. That's why God gives us this gift. That's why Jesus is also known as the Lamb of God. And it's just fair that the Lamb of God was born in a place where the lambs are born. And he was wrapped and he was taken care of. Because in the same way, when the lamb had the first baby, they will take care of him. The shepherds will take him actually to a stable. So it's a controlled space. And the lamb will be taken care of because that was going to be dedicated later on as a sacrifice. And that's why Jesus came here. Not just to teach us, not just to do miracles, not just to heal, not just to feed, but to save. To save you and me. My friend, you might be sitting in these chairs for too long, but you have not yet experienced this gift. Nothing that you do, nothing that you can start doing today will change your destiny unless it's accepting this gift. This is the expensive stuff. Now, 1 John. Now, Jesus is a grown man. He's in his 30s. He's starting his ministry. John the Baptist is there with his disciples. And when he sees Jesus walking by at the distance, he says, behold, that's the Lamb of God. He will take away the sin of the world. Same thing prophesied by Isaiah, hundreds of years. He will be the Lamb. He will be the one that redeemed. He will be the one that pays the price. God shows his love for us, that even for us, being imperfect, being for us, being separated from God, he gifted us with his son. Guys, this is not something that is for us to hear and, oh, I wish my uncle was here. He needs to hear this. I wish my neighbor who has all these obnoxious lights going into my window will be here. He needs salvation, not lights. Right? No, this is for us, guys. God gave you a present that no one else can do. Do not pass it along. Do not wish for somebody else to have it. On this one, it's okay to be a little bit selfish. You take that gift first. Finally, verse 36. Anna, a prophet was also there in the temple. She was the daughter of Phanuel from the tribe of Asher, and she was very old. Her husband died when they had been married only 7 years. Then she lived as a widow of the age of 84. She never left the temple, but stayed there day and night, worshiping God and fasting and prayer. She came along just as Simeon was taken to Mary and Joseph, and she began praising God. She talked about the child that everyone who had been waiting expectantly for God to rescue Jerusalem. Something that we measure when we receive a gift, or something we measure when we are buying a gift, is the longevity. How much is the life shelf of this gift? How much is going to last, right? And we make our research before buying it, or even when we're holding it, right? We want to make sure that it lasts for the time that is intended to last. Don't you guys get frustrated when you get a new toy, when you get something new and you start using it and it breaks apart in your hands? That's a bummer, right? Or when you start wanting to work, Lucas got this pretty cool thing that is a metal detector. Hopefully that will pay for all the other gifts. So, and it's amazing, right? And okay, let's see it. Let's take it to the park. Let's try it. And we will take it on vacation, so that also pays for the vacation. We have high hopes in that gift, right? And we are planning that gift will pay on itself, right? And okay, well, that little thing takes 2 batteries, which we don't have. So we will be testing it today. I'll tell you next week. But, right? What good is a gift if it's not properly set up, if it's not properly charged? Guys, what good is a gift if you are not taking advantage of it? And again, when you're using something, you want to make sure it's going to last. It's going to give you hours of fun. Or if it's something for craft, it will give you a great way to create something. The longevity of this gift that is given to us has an eternal warranty forever. Now, this woman, Anna, she was a prophet. The Bible is telling us that she was a widow 7 years after marriage, and at least she was 84 years old. We are not going to get into a debate with Luke here, but there are some views that says, okay, she was total 84 years old. Somebody might say, well, it was 84 years as a widow plus the 7, plus the, if she got married when she was really young, she might be over 100 years old. No matter where we stand in this one, we are not going to start splitting hairs because I have none, but what we need to see here is this woman was advanced in years. This woman was a prophet from God. And this woman knew her history. And she knew that Israel has been conquered again over 20 times for decades, for centuries. She was born, being with Israel in captivity, and she was really waiting for this Messiah, for this Savior, for this Redeemer to come. She knew, as a prophet of God, that there was actually no prophecies, no messages, no visions for the last 400 years. 400 years of silence. In a culture when today, if we send a text message and if we don't receive it immediately, we start freaking out. Imagine you don't receive a text message in 400 years. Or you go at 3 o'clock in the morning hunting when you should be at 3 p.m. Now I know who made it to the Christmas Eve service. Anna knew that redemption was here. and same as Simeon. She saw in this little gift from God, in this little baby, an opportunity to put an end to a history of failure, to a history of frustration, to a history of putting the faith in someone else will do it. And when she saw Jesus as a baby, she surrendered and she was ready. And she probably had it very clear, because she was advanced in years, that she wouldn't be there long enough to see this baby to become a man and to do his first miracle in Cana or to feed 5,000. She wasn't in that crowd. I pretty much can guarantee that. But she knew what Jesus was going to do. Guys, 2,000 years have passed, and we have a blessing that now we know. And no matter what we know, we are victorious. And no matter if this might be a harder season for you, I just wanted to let you know that this gift of salvation is all you need. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. That might not change your circumstances right now. That's not going to change your circumstances at lunch. But this has an eternal warranty. Let's look at the big picture. The same way that Simeon, the same way that Hannah did. They saw this gift from God, unexpected. It had an emotional value. It was an expensive cost for this baby. And now we know that this gift is something that we would cherish and we could have forever. It's nice on all this season when I get to have so many conversations and kids get to share with me so many things. When they share some of their traditions and when some of them show me, okay, this ornament that we have in the tree, this belong to my grandfather, right? And I'm pretty sure he's not the only one. Many of you might have one of these mementos that it has a special value during the Christmas season when you put this ornament or when you have collecting these old Christmas photos or cards, even maybe from people that is no longer here with you. Guys, this is a gift that is worth keeping. We wrap it up with this. Why is okay to re-gift? Okay? I give you a ray of hope. Why is okay to re-gift? Because Jesus came and he died on the cross. And on the third day, he resurrected. And after that, he stayed with his disciples for 40 more days. And he came and he told his disciples, I have been giving all authority in heaven and on earth. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. You got this gift. Now let's go. Give it away. It's the gift that keeps on giving. Right? Guys, it is such an amazing thing, like Brandon was saying, to see baptisms, to see people making this declaration, because that means that they took this gift and made it their own, and they're making a declaration. I want to tell the world that I'm obeying, that I want to follow Jesus. For us, as we still have many leftovers to share and many extra parties maybe to attend, use this opportunity to tell the story of Jesus, to give the gift that makes a difference. Because this is the beauty. Nothing else will fill that void. We can go and we can chase him and we can shake other boxes and we can try to find it in money, in work, in relationships, in families. Those are little, shiny, beautiful things, right? But that will never replace the Lamb of God that came and died for us. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for your gift. Thank you for the profound gift in knowing you. For loving us so much that you repair our existence and our eternity in the gift of Jesus for us. Help us, God, to value, to cherish what Jesus did for us in the cross. Help us, God, to share it with those who yet don't know it. Help us, God, to make a point in our lives to go into our neighborhoods, into our city, into our nation, into our world, and give and share this gift with others. In your name we pray. Amen.